In 1976, NASA successfully landed two probes, Viking 1 and 2, on Mars, to go on to a highly successful mission that returned the first good images of the surface of Mars. I stress good because there is somewhat of a mystery hidden in the question of just when the first image from the surface of Mars was obtained. The Soviet Union actually sent a probe, Mars 3, in 1971, that seems to have been a very unlucky probe. It was lucky enough to make a landing. The braking, parachutes, and other operations were successful, and the probe began operations on the surface of Mars 90 seconds after landing. But when it went to transmit an image, it stopped after 20 seconds for unknown reasons. This probe was really unlucky in that it landed right during a severe dust storm, and one hypothesis as to why it stopped working was a static electricity discharge that disabled the probe, and even that probe's parachute might have pulled it on its side. This is the sole image it sent back, not much there conclusively. The Viking landers, however, returned stunning images for years, and indeed Viking 1 never actually failed, and was still transmitting data in 1982, when an erroneous software upgrade sent to it caused its antenna to retract and the probe to unrecoverably shut down. The Viking probes were large platforms. As you can see here, they were somewhere, about 1.2 Carl Sagan's tall. And being that large, even in the 1970s, carried robust instrument packages for their time. Four of these were ambitious, but for its time made sense, and were designed to try to determine if there was active biology, life, on the surface or near the surface of Mars. The result in at least one of the experiments was, shockingly at the time, a positive that still stands. Here is what happened. The first experiment was what is known as a gas chromatograph mass spectrometer, and what these do is separate gas vapors and then feed the results into a spectrometer for analysis. In other words, you put the soil in, heat it, and see what chemicals come out. The result was that Mars's soil was very poor in organic molecules. The result was actually worse than the moon, not good for life. This took a turn for the weird because the lack of organics was mostly the basis for the general dismissal of the possibility of life on Mars to date, which plays directly into another of Viking's experiments. More on that in a bit. But since the Viking landers, we've sent rovers and we now know that Mars does indeed have organics in its soil. In fact, the discovery of those organics presented somewhat of an about-face because the argument went from, well, Mars probably doesn't have life because of a lack of organics, to it shouldn't be surprising that Mars has organics, but it doesn't indicate life. Which in fairness is true, but the shift was notable from certain sectors. The reality is that this specific experiment may have been tricked. In 2008, NASA landed the Phoenix lander on Mars and it detected perchlorate in the Martian soil. Much has been made of this. But the reality is that perchlorate is too poor of an oxidizer when it's cool to have destroyed the missing organics seen by Viking. But it gets better at it the hotter things are, so it could have done that to the point the organic molecules were destroyed at the heat ranges Viking's experiment was operating, and they had indeed been present. The argument against the detections has degraded as a result. There also is a further mystery with this experiment. There actually were organic detections, specifically chloromethane and dichloromethane, but the results were discarded as contamination from the cleaning fluid used when manufacturing the instrument. There was a solid reason for that. The isotope ratios they observed were similar to Earth. So that sat dead for many years, but a more recent experiment took perchlorate after the Phoenix detection and added it to desert soil from Chile that contained organics, repeating the Viking experiments. Lo and behold, the result was in fact those two chemicals. It remains possible that with these two chemicals, Mars may simply have similar ratios to Earth. We don't know. It hasn't yet been measured on Mars. The next experiment was known as the gas exchange experiment. This experiment would take a soil sample and replace the Martian atmosphere with helium, which is inert. It then soaked the soil in a liquid containing nutrients and later water. The instrument then looked at the gases coming out of the soil, specifically looking for oxygen, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, hydrogen, and methane, basically gases that might be produced by microbial life or consumed by it. The result? Oxygen disappeared and carbon dioxide appeared, which was not conclusive and chalked up to abiotic chemistry, but it has to be noted that's precisely what we do when we breathe. So two inconclusive results so far that may have been positive detections of life or supports that. The third experiment was the pyrolytic release experiment. This experiment took a simulated Martian environment with carbon monoxide, dioxide, water, light, and so on, but with a key difference. The carbon-bearing gases were made with carbon-14, which is a radioactive isotope. That way, if photosynthesizing organisms were incorporating that isotope into their biomass, a process known as carbon fixation, it would be detectable. They inserted the soil into the experiment, gave it a few days, and then removed the gas, and baked the sample, and took a look for the carbon-14. Here's the thing. It came back a positive. Once again, an instrument designed to detect life in the Martian soil returned a yes answer, and once again it was chalked up to being due to some chemical process, and not life. Yet this experiment had a sterile control sample, and that did not return a positive result. That too sat in obscurity for years regarding Viking, though in recent years it's moved more into the maybe territory, as no explanation for just what happened to there chemically has come to light. It still looks like biology that did it. The final experiment is much more well known. This was the famous labeled release experiment, and it was by far the most promising of the experimental suite. Here a sample of Martian soil was taken into the lander, and a solution of nutrients were added. The nutrients chosen were the seven molecules that had been observed in the enigmatic Miller-Urey experiment, where the atmosphere of early Earth was recreated, electricity was added, chemical elements were added, and out came all manner of life-related chemicals, such as sugars and amino acids. The soil was then monitored to see if anything ate and metabolized the nutrients, and the answer was that, yes, something did. Again, the carbon used here was carbon-14, so detecting gases from the metabolism was really an exercise in looking for radioactive gases. The experiment continued. They then took the soil samples and sterilized them, and repeated the experiment. Samples heated long-term gave off no gases, implying that whatever was in the soil that was producing the gases stopped after sterilization. Further experiments found that heating for shorter periods of time reduced the amount of gases. The samples stored long-term also saw reduced activity when the experiment was repeated. In short, whatever it was, it behaved similarly to bacteria on Earth. That's 4 out of 4 experiments repeated on both landers, all detecting to varying degrees some evidence for active life in the soil of Mars, in 2 separate, widely distant areas on the planet. The result was a healthy dose of skepticism from the scientific community. One wonders why there wasn't more attention given to that before the experiments launched, so the experiments could have been improved to produce less ambiguous results. And the whole affair became obscure. Yet to this day, no good explanation has ever arisen for 2 of the results. And more recently, interest in these experiments has grown, and there has been some re-evaluation. The designers of the labeled release experiment stuck by their guns. I interviewed one of them, Dr. Patricia Ann Straat, on Event Horizon shortly before her passing, link in the description below, and no refutation of the results of the labeled release experiment has ever successfully knocked it out. It's simply seen as ambiguous, despite all of the experiments having done exactly what they were designed to do. It's just that the results were questioned at a time when it was popular to say, in those days, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. Well, as I've said before, there is no such thing as extraordinary evidence. There isn't extraordinary evidence for anything. There is merely just evidence. The question is, how good is that evidence? The fact is, we have evidence of microbial life on Mars. Is it good evidence? Well, it was evidence collected by purpose-built scientific instruments that was repeated to the same result. That's usually plenty in most areas of science. As to how good it is, the first of the two experiments, not so much, because alternative explanations have come up that are viable, even though they do remain consistent with biology. The final two experiments, however, do not have particularly good alternate explanations, and it boils down to extraordinary results, and surely not, it can't be, therefore it isn't. And all of this happened in a rather odd framework, where scientists in the 1970s and 80s were not particularly surprised by the lack of organics in the Viking gas chromatograph mass spectrometer experiment. Now the general consensus has shifted towards it would have been extremely odd if Mars had no organics in its soil. That's now seen as highly unlikely and abnormal because organic chemistry is all over the solar system. This has led to the re-evaluation of the Viking experiments, and now there is a new addition to the issue. Recently, astrobiologist Dirk Schultz-Makuk pointed out a further dimension to the Viking life-finding experiments. It's the idea that, yeah, Viking might have discovered life in the Martian soil, but because all of the experiments were based in water, that may actually be a problem for the results, because they may have killed the very microbes they were looking for. Mars is very dry. It's worse than the most arid deserts on Earth. Microbial life exists in those environments, such as the Atacama Desert. But some of those microbes make use of salts, so directly draw humidity from the air. The problem is that makes them water sensitive. Too much is bad. That happens in the Atacama Desert, where heavy rains occur there very rarely. 70 to 80% of the local bacteria die off because they can't handle the influx of water. That may be the case for the Martian microbes, in which case the addition of water would overwhelm and kill them if their biochemistry functions that way. All of the Viking experiments worked under the assumption that life, if it is like that of Earth and can be detected, would require water no matter what. But maybe not, it turns out. This may have greater implications because NASA's current strategy in searching for life in the solar system is to follow the water. But it may also be useful to follow the salts. Not all salts are great for this, because of the properties and how they deal with water, but sodium chloride, regular table salt, is excellent in this regard. And it's very common and predominant at Mars. Mars colonists will not need to import salt from Earth by any means. One effect of the labeled release experiment, however, was that it actually made NASA rather gun-shy for decades on direct life detection experiments. Rather, they have tended to focus on broader experiments like follow the water. And while that was what they could do politically after the ambiguity of the Viking experiments, it may not have been the best approach because they aren't the sole group in the game as far as putting human boots on Mars. There are others, and the most advanced at it is SpaceX. And while you can have any opinion you like of that, they do march forward in sending someone in some capacity to the surface of Mars. Human boots on Martian soil. And if there really is life in the soil itself rather than locked up in some deep aquifer, a life detection experiment in the preparations of a private human landing, well before we actually do it, might be very prudent indeed. Just saying. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently perplexed about a story that will be the subject of the next video, and it deals directly with microbial life detections. As I finished the script at 2:05 in the morning, the night before I will release the video, it gave me chills, and it just happened. Very interesting stuff. Look for it around Friday or Saturday, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.